Hello again. We've reached almost the end of our journey through the music of Georg Ligeti. However, there's still something we haven't really looked at yet, and that's his use of microtones and microtonality. But why would he use microtones in his music? Well, here there was another tool he could exploit to further enhance the expressive qualities of his music, another tool that he could use to create new and unique sonorities. And we know that he was fascinated with the microtonal music because he thought it gave him the opportunity to write something that was neither tonal nor atonal. He sometimes called microtonal music dirty music, and he used to play with the contrast between microtonal music and non-microtonal music in his pieces. He uses microtonality, for example, in his 1968-69 piece called Ramification, for 12 string instruments, in which six of the players are instructed to tune their instruments a quarter tone higher. He also uses microtonality in his double concerto, in his violin concerto. But after that, something changes a little in the way he uses microtonality, because he had the chance in the United States to meet Harry Partch. Harry Partch focused almost his entire career on microtonal music. And before Ligeti met Harry Partch, he was using microtonality in a fairly free way, depending on what he felt were the necessary, let's say, expressive needs of the music. But after meeting Harry Partch, that changed a little bit, because Harry Partch had a very different approach. He was a lot more systematic about the way in which he wrote microtonal music. He made his own instruments to perform his music on, and all that fascinated Ligeti. And when he went back to Europe, if you may remember, he wrote this article about new tendencies in the new music of the United States. And in that article, Harry Partch is mentioned. And then the way he uses microtonality after that, in his horn trio, but especially in one of his last pieces, which is the Hamburg Concerto, which is basically a horn concerto, is different. Because the horn, the use of the horn, the natural horn especially, or the modern horn but used in the same way as the natural horn, offered him more like a system. Like Harry Partch's system, let's say, in which he could compose, arrange his microtonal music. And I mentioned the natural horn, but the natural horn, some of you will know, hopefully, produces all the sounds through harmonics, overtones. Well, there's another instrument that Ligeti perhaps heard. I heard as a child in Transylvania. Ligeti might have heard when he was growing up or as a young man, and that's buccium, which is a very strange looking wind instrument, very long, and that instrument has no keys, no holes, and all the sounds are produced through harmonics, and some of them are, of course, microtonal. Another instrument that Ligeti probably heard in Transylvania was the ocarina, and ocarina, yes, it can be tuned to perfect Western standard well-tempered intonation. However, the ocarina has a very unstable pitch, and often, especially in folk music, when it is played, the sounds are bent downwards or upwards, and they can hit just under or above a note, sounding microtonal. And we know Ligeti used ocarinas in his violin concerto as well as other composers from the area, for example, Penderecki. But let's go back to the Hamburg Concerto, which Ligeti wrote at the end of his life, as I said. The Hamburg Concerto is a horn concerto. However, there's also a sort of a choir of four additional natural horns. The solo horn is not a natural horn, however, is performed and is used like a natural horn, because most of the notes, especially, even the fast passages, are always practically obtained through using overtones rather than through fingerings. And This group of made of the solo horn and the other four horns are providing the microtonal music, and then the rest of the chamber orchestra play in well-tempered intonation. And Ligeti plays all throughout the piece with this opposition between microtonal and well-tempered music. Another thing that happened towards the end of his life was that almost all his last large-scale works are using very short movements, almost the miniature-like movements, in a sense almost like the piano etudes, but altogether, of course, they form larger-scale work, and sometimes the material is very similar throughout all the movements, but treated differently from movement to movement. Exactly that happens in the Hamburg Concerto as well. There are seven short movements that altogether can be played from beginning to the end in less than 15 minutes. But those 15 minutes are some of the most difficult 15 minutes of music ever written for the horn. And the rest of the orchestra has quite a challenge as well. The flute, the oboe are required to play notes which are well outside their usual range, and in fact often the players have to find ways to work around that. It's a very challenging piece of music, and I think we should listen to a short excerpt now from the Hamburg Concerto. Some unique sounding music. It's often described as beautiful, otherworldly, but also strange and bizarre. Well, it's also Ligeti. I hope you realized through these videos how rich and varied and contrasting his music was. He never stopped searching for something. He never arrived, not because he was dissatisfied with what he was writing, but because he was always curious, always looking for the new. He had a long musical journey. It started during the post-Bartok sound world, and it continued with a move towards the avant-garde, also as a protest towards those repressive regimes he had to escape from and their censorship. But then he became dissatisfied with the avant-garde and he found his own voice with the discovery of micropolyphony. Then he became fascinated by machines, especially broken machines and mechanical instruments and mechanical machines. And he wrote a sort of music of patterns repeated, which also resembles a little bit the music of the minimalist composers. He also flirted with music drama, first with pieces like Avanture and Nouvelle Avanture, but then especially in his opera Le Grand Macabre. Then he discovered the music of the Banda Linda and Conlon and Carol, and he developed himself a much more polyrhythmic music. It was a music of many dimensions and many faces, let's say, but somehow he was always himself. I like this sentence I read in his obituary in the Telegraph newspaper. It said, like Stravinsky, he could assume all kinds of borrowed musical guises, yet remain completely himself, which is totally true. His music, although so different, always sounds like Ligeti. And speaking again about his music, I regret not being able to talk about some of his other pieces, because you shouldn't imagine that the music I selected is his best music. We left out some of his best music. Unfortunately, it's impossible to put everything in. I only selected these pieces of music, which I did, because I thought they illustrated well what I was talking about in a particular video. But I definitely encourage you to go and explore further, especially the concertos, which we really didn't look at much. His violin concerto, his piano concerto, the double concerto, the chamber concerto, his cello concerto, and also other pieces like San Francisco Polyphony, Clocks and Cloud, or Hungarian Rock. Continue the exploration on your own. Hopefully, what these videos will help you with is understand some of the main characteristics of his music, which will help you understand the rest of his music as well. I would like to conclude with a couple of quotes. First one from Tom Service in The Guardian. He wrote, "You might expect the music of this remarkable life to express a searing, protesting intensity, but for all its directness, it is neither politically charged nor nihilistic." He has said that anyone who has been through horrifying experiences is not likely to create terrifying works of art in all seriousness. He's more likely to alienate. That alienation is expressed as uncompromising musical independence. His music suspends and transfigures its influences, from East European folk music to African polyrhythms, from literary surrealism to fractal geometry. And to conclude, here's a paragraph from a book called The Rest is Noise by Alex Ross. Georg Ligeti, in his last years, was reportedly haunted by the feeling that he would be forgotten after his death, that he had outlived the age in which music mattered. Perhaps Ligeti was right. Perhaps classical composition is being sustained past its date of expiration by the stubborn determination of those who perform it, those who support it, and above all, those who write it. More likely, though, a thousand-year-old tradition won't expire with the flipping of a calendar or the aging of a baby boom cohort. Confusion is often a prelude to consolidation. We may even be on the verge of a new golden age. For now, the art is like the sunken cathedral that the Debussy depicts in his Preludes for Piano, a city that chants beneath the waves. Thank you for watching.